Hi everyone, welcome to the talk. I'm Savita. I'm here with my co-speaker, Samir. We're happy to be presenting the Dirty Cow story on Yahoo Grid to you. Hope you enjoy the talk. So this is the agenda for today's presentation. I'll get started by giving you an overview of what exactly the issue at hand was, all the challenges we faced, and I'll get into the details of the planning, preparation, execution, and coordination that was needed for this project. Thereafter, Samir will take over and get into the details of the automation that was written for this project. And he will conclude, and we should have some time for Q&A at the end. So, what is Dirty Cow? Dirty copy and write is a security vulnerability that's been around for almost a decade. It affects all versions of Linux that were released over the last 10 years, starting from version 2.6. It is a privilege escalation attack, which a local user can exploit to gain super user privileges. This is a vulnerability due to a race condition that exists in the copy on write mechanism that exists for the Linux kernel's memory management system. It's been around for almost a decade now, but it was actively exploited and it surfaced around October of last year. That's when numerous distributions of Linux came out with fixes and released patched versions of the kernel. So the fix for this basically involves upgrading to the patched kernel and following it up with a complete system reboot. So the fix sounds simple, right? I mean, it's a kernel upgrade followed by a reboot. What was challenging? Well, we were faced with a number of challenges. First off, the scale. Yahoo's grid comprises of 38 clusters, 19 Hadoop clusters, 9 HBase clusters, 10 Storm clusters, with a total of over 47,000 nodes of diverse kinds of makes and models. This is the Yahoo grid stack. As you can see, it contains Hadoop with HDFS for storage, Yarn and Thaes for batch processing, Storm for stream processing, Spark for real-time processing, HCatalog is for metadata registry, HBase is the NoSQL store, and all the other subcomponents that work off of the Hadoop stack, like PIG, OOSI, HDFS proxy, grid data management systems, and so on. There's also the support infrastructure, like zookeepers, LDAP, Kerberos for security, monitoring servers, admin servers, logging, syslog servers. So all of these servers needed to be upgraded and rebooted. So moving on from scale, there were other challenges that we faced. Like, there was a time constraint. We had an end of quarter deadline. And then the requirements that came along with this project were challenges. Like, we could not afford any data loss. And we had to come up with as minimal as a downtime as possible so that there is not too much inconvenience to the users of the platform. Also, coordinating the whole effort among the different teams that were using the platform was a challenge, mainly because all of the systems that I just listed are multi-tenant systems with users of different kind of use cases, having different SLAs running at different times of the day. So carving out a time frame to do the maintenance and getting an agreement and coordinating it among the different teams who were using the platform was a challenge. Last but not the least, automation. We had to come up with rigorous end-to-end automation for this entire thing, given the scale at which it had to be done. And this had to be done in a short span. Planning and preparation. Yahoo's grid systems are in a very high security zone, and access to these systems goes through several rounds of verification and approvals. There are periodic auditing jobs that run to make sure that the right set of users have access to the system. So right there, we ruled out the possibility of any imminent attack, and it gave us time to plan for this whole thing, given that the Dirty Cow vulnerability can be exploited only if the user had access to the system. So there were numerous discussions that were held between the dev team and the production operations team, and a number of interesting ideas were discussed, which I'll go through now. First off, we wanted to leverage the existing framework to do the upgrade. Next, we wanted to be scanning all the hosts in the clusters to see if they were healthy enough to sustain a kernel upgrade. Many of these hosts weren't rebooted in ages. So the behavior of these hosts on a kernel upgrade and a complete system reboot was uncertain. We wanted to be thoroughly testing the new kernel on all kinds of hardware, on all kinds of makes and models of hosts, and even different versions of OS, all of which were within a 0.2 to 0.4 below the OS at which the patched kernel was for. We wanted to be ruling out any issues with C groups or IP tables and the fact that those functionalities work as expected. On testing the new kernel on our non-production systems, we encountered some issues. We had issues with IPMI. We had issues with lower clock speed for CPU. So it was decided upon that we would do a BIOS, BMC, and CPLD upgrade along with the kernel upgrade for those particular types of hosts. Lastly, it was decided that we will use kexec where time was a constraint. Kexec is a system call to boot and load the kernel from within a running kernel. It skips the hardware initialization done by the BIOS part of the bootloader, and that reduces the boot time significantly. The execution. The execution was divided into a number of phases. The first phase was done a week or two before the upgrade. So what would happen is we would push out hardware checks onto all the hosts in the clusters and run these checks. These checks were basically looking for memory, CPU, and disk issues. And the metrics collected from these checks were sent back to a central logging central server where it was persisted to a database, and it was powering a UI. So we had a UI which would tell us all the hosts in the cluster which had hardware issues. Hosts with critical hardware issues would be decommissioned from the cluster, while hosts with minor issues like one drive failure and things like that would be left intact, and they would be dealt with as we did the upgrade. The reason behind not decommissioning all of the hosts with issues was basically we did not want to be affecting the capacity of the cluster. Previously, I said that we leveraged the existing framework to do the upgrades. What I meant was we kept the name nodes up and running throughout the entire kernel upgrade process to help with metrics like missing blocks and under-replicated blocks. The name node high availability setup at Yahoo uses IP aliasing. It has a HA1, a HA2 alias, and a service IP alias of NN1. So the idea was to bring the NN1 alone down as the clients and all the subsystem components talk to NN1. So we would bring down NN1 while we would keep the name nodes up and running and let them do their job of finding missing blocks and under-replicated blocks and help us through the process of data node upgrade. So a day before the upgrade, we would push out the new kernel onto all of the hosts in the system and run some basic validation to make sure that everything looks good. On the day of the upgrade, we would start off with a name node settings change. For instance, we increased the name node heartbeat reach check interval. This setting has a default value of 10 seconds. We relaxed it to 20 seconds, mainly because knowing that the data nodes were being worked on and there was a kernel upgrade happening, we did not want the name nodes to be too sensitive to not hearing back from the data nodes. But a settings change on the name node required a name node process restart. So we used this as an opportunity to upgrade the name nodes. So we would do a settings change, restart the standby, failover, restart the primary, and the name nodes will be up and ready with the new kernel and the settings change as the first step in the kernel upgrade process. Then we would run a block map reporting tool. What this script would do is it would produce a flat file with a listing of all the hosts in the clusters to all the maps on all the blocks on each of the hosts. This information was very handy to have to recover data nodes that didn't come back up after the reboot. The actual upgrade consisted of us taking down the NN1 interface, and we would also shut down the services which would anyway fail since NN1 was down, and then we would start with the data node upgrade process. For the data node upgrades, we would start off by doing one rack and one stripe, and depending on how that goes, we would decide our next steps. Now, one rack is 40 nodes, and one stripe is one node from every rack in the cluster. This idea was decided upon mainly from feedback from our SiteOps team that if we were to take down multiple racks and reboot them, then it would cause power surges and other kinds of power issues. For clusters with newer hardware, this would go pretty smooth, and we would increase the stripe count in multiples of 2, 3. We've even done 10x in certain cases. But with, for clusters with relatively old hardware, we would face issues where the data nodes wouldn't come back up, and then we would use the information from the block map tool to figure out which data node had a lot of those blocks. And based on the missing node and the under-replicated information from the name node UI, we will find that data node, troubleshoot it, bring it back up, make sure that the missing block and under-replicated block are within a certain threshold, and then proceed with the next batch of stripes. Lastly, the resource manager will be upgraded and brought back up. Also, when someone in the team is working on upgrading the data nodes, there will be another person in the team who is upgrading the services for the subsystem servers, mainly because we wanted to make the best use of the downtime that was scheduled. For low latency systems like HBase and Storm, the existing rolling upgrade scripts were updated to have a system upgrade module. What this module would do is it would do a host validation. It would basically check the memory, CPU, and disks on the host. If that looked good, it would check the kernel to see if it's the latest version. If that looked good, then it would go ahead and, in case of HBase, it would unload the regions, stop the services, reboot the host, and once the hosts are back up, it would. If there is a software upgrade also in the option, then it would do the software upgrade, restart the services, then reload the regions, and bring the node back up. And then it would move on to the next node. This was a nice functionality to have added to our rolling upgrade script, given that it can come in handy in future when it's needed again. Subsystems upgrade. I did say that the subsystem servers were upgraded when the name node interface NN1 was brought down. But there were cases when we couldn't do the subsystem upgrade during the downtime, and we would deal with it separately after the downtime. And in that case, there wouldn't be any impact to the users. The kernel upgrade script had a functionality built into it to do a rolling upgrade on these subsystems. All of the subsystems at the Yahoo grid have a lot of redundancy built into them. Even LDAP and Kerberos, for that matter, are a multi-master, master-slave setup with numerous slaves. There are multiple servers for each of the services behind a load balancer, and there is no single point of failure. So the rolling upgrade script would take a host out of rotation, upgrade, put it back into rotation, and work on the next one. Coordination. There was a comprehensive UI that was built for this entire effort. This UI would list all the clusters in all of the data centers. It would list all the hosts in each of the clusters. It would display host health stats. It would display the status of all the upgrades like the BIOS or the kernel upgrade progress. And it was a very nice UI to have around, and it was used extensively by the operations team as well as the dev teams and the management when they needed to know the status of the upgrade or the status of the health of a host. Our second tier of operations would use the unreachable node information from this UI to follow up with SiteOps, and there was a SiteOps personnel always on hold during these downtime windows. So they would follow up on that and get the nodes fixed as soon as possible so that they're back into rotation as soon as possible. So this is the snapshot of the UI I was talking about. For instance, in this page, it gives a list of all the services from all the data centers. It has a total count of all the servers for each of the services. It has an upgrade completed count of all the servers for each of the services, and there is a percent completed metric as well. On this page, it shows cluster-specific information, like a particular cluster is selected over here, and for that, it lists all the services in that particular cluster. It lists the state and the status of the group of hosts, and there's also a description on what each state means. For instance, here you can see there are like around 5 states: a kernel current, a host validation failed, host validation passed, unreachable, and added to cluster. So for instance, kernel current means that the hosts have been rebooted, they're back up with the current kernel, and they're good to go. Host validation failed means that the hardware check on the host for memory or disk or CPU failed for some reason, and it even lists the reason why it failed. Like over here, it says /home not enough space. And unreachable are nodes that did not come back up after a reboot. And this is where I said our second tier of operations would follow up with SiteOps to get them repaired and back up as soon as possible. And there's a host validation passed, which means that hardware checks went through fine and they're good to be rebooted and brought up with the latest kernel. And added to the cluster basically means that kernel upgrade is done, services have been started, and those nodes have been added back into the cluster. From here on, we will go into the details of the automations that were put in place for this project, and Samir will be covering that part. Thank you.
Thanks, Savita. Hello, friends. I will continue with the workflow and the algorithm that we use to do the kernel upgrade on Hadoop cluster with on multi-components and on clusters of massive scale with minimum downtime and with minimum user intervention. Let me try to explain you the workflow that we use to do a kernel upgrade for a typical Hadoop cluster. We broke this part into two parts. The first part was done the day before when we actually did the maintenance. And we used to run tests or scans across all the nodes on the cluster to find out anomalies, issues on the nodes and components, to find out the nodes that are active, non-active, the nodes which are which are unreachable and basically already have the kernel upgraded, which can be excluded from the upgrade. Once we had the list of the nodes, we would push the repo on the nodes, and then we would move the old kernel to a temporary location. This actually added some complexity when we were doing this upgrade. The reason for doing that was because the time when we built the systems, those were built with root file system much smaller, and they could not accommodate both the kernels. So we had to actually move the old kernel to a temporary file system. We were well aware that in case of reverting back, we had to add some more steps to revert back the old kernel. Then we used to do the RPM push on the nodes. And so here, if you see, every step had a failed threshold. And whenever the threshold used to cross, the automation used to terminate, and we used to move back to fixing it, and then moving on to the next set. Then we would validate the nodes. And then once we had the node list, we would be prepared for doing the maintenance on the next day. So next day, we would have a batch to work on. I will go more into the batch in my future slides. But then with this, we would shut down the processes on the nodes, reboot the nodes, and then we would have a threshold for failure on reboots. And then services would be started, and then finally the SDFS would be checked. So all these thresholds which were there, like RPM failure, service failure, or reboot failure, these were all checked at this time. And if the threshold crossed on any of these failures, the whole process would terminate, and we would work on to debugging those problems and fix it before we move to the next batch. Talking about threshold, missing block was a very important threshold in our test. So basically, we didn't want to have the missing block go to a very high level and then fixing it. So we had some threshold for a missing block. And that was configurable per cluster, per config kind of thing. So what we used to do was we used to have a block mapping of map of the blocks to the nodes and saved on a current file system as well as on a remote cluster. And whenever we used to run the tool, it used to be monitoring the missing blocks. And whenever the missing blocks trigger or the threshold used to occur, it used to send trigger a meta save to the name node. And then we used to come up with a list of the nodes that were failing. And so basically what we used to do is we had a tool which we ran across on the block map to find out which nodes, if brought back up, would bring up all the missing blocks. We didn't have to bring up all the nodes, only those nodes which would fix all the missing blocks. So, and then once we had the list, we would try to debug, and the nodes which were actually down and had some issues, we would escalate to a remote team, which were the site ops, and they would fix it, and then we would start the services, and then start with the next batch. Tool config. So tool config was basically had the logic or the intelligence on which the kernel upgrade was built on. So I'll break it up into multiple parts. This was basically a MySQL database where we stored the configs. We stored stuff like we had a NetSwitch mapping where the switch to host mapping was done. And this was done before the maintenance started. And we used to load this in memory so that the querying for host to racks was done quicker. This helped us with the batching and stuff. How do we correlate a host, which switch it belongs to, those kind of things. Then we also had these settings where we defined in this tool. So basically, we tried to make this tool as modular as possible. So we could add these arguments like reboot weight, missing block threshold, what kind of nodes we are upgrading. So basically, here we have defined the reboot weight as 25 minutes. So which means if we start the upgrade, it will wait for up to 25 minutes until it will declare the node as unreachable and failed reboot. Similarly, for missing blocks, here we have set up the missing block threshold as 1,000. So until it reaches the threshold of 1,000, the kernel upgrade would continue. And once it reaches the threshold of 1,000, it would terminate. And then we would have to debug on what exactly is causing the missing blocks to go that high, and we would fix it. This was configurable on cluster or on the type of nodes we were dealing with. On some kind of old nodes which were very unreliable, the threshold would be obviously lower. Going ahead about the logic for batch selection. So we decided to specify batches based on three categories. One was tripe, one was racks, and one was the number of nodes. So this, when we had a meeting initially about this kernel upgrade, we had numerous meetings with SiteOps, and SiteOps told us that we should not be booting multiple racks at the same time because that will add some load on the PDUs. So that's why we defined racks, stripes, where a single node across all the switches would comprise a single stripe. So here as an example, we have put like rack, stripe, 50, 100, and stop. So this stop was something where if you want to stop it at some level, it will stop. Unless it comes to a threshold, it reaches a threshold and stop before that. So in this file, we have put it like rack, stripe, 4S, 7S. So since we have not given a stop, it would continue with a stripe size of 7 until it encounters a threshold. So we also use this tool config to define commands. So basically, we try to make it like a plug and play modular thing where we were giving all the commands in the tool itself. So here we have given a reboot command where we were trying to reboot nodes with kexec. I will go about kexec in my next further slides. Rolling upgrade for low latency services. So as I told you, we tried to make this kernel upgrade as a modular tool, and we tried to integrate into our existing rolling upgrade tool for both Edgebase and Storm. So the build was done on Jenkins using CI/CD process, and just like a regular rolling upgrade, we used to start with the name nodes, and the standby name nodes would be upgraded and then failed over, and then the new standby name node would be upgraded, and then we would do the master. And then we would start with the region servers. So for region servers, we used to do it on a per group basis. So first we will take one group and we will start with region servers for that group. And we would basically do a system upgrade on those nodes, offload the regions, push the repo server on that node, and then stop the region server, stop other services like data node, reboot the node, validate the services, whether they started or not, data node and region services. And once all the region servers were done, we would do the Edgebase REST. And then finally, we would do a gateway upgrade, and we would run health checks on the cluster to validate the cluster is doing fine, and then we would conclude that the upgrade is completed. Similarly, for Storm, we were following the same process of upgrade. We were using the release using Jenkins and with CI/CD, and the state files were saved in the Artifactory. So for Storm, we were starting with a pacemaker. So pacemaker is like a Storm daemon which is going to process the heartbeats for the supervisor nodes. So this had some redundancy, and it would do the rolling upgrade in the rolling fashion, where each one node is taken down, upgraded, and then moved on. Then once the pacemaker was done, it would start with Nimbus. Nimbus is like the master for the Storm cluster. And it doesn't have redundancy, it's a standalone machine, so it would take it down. Once it comes back up, then we'll start with the supervisors. So supervisors, like Edgebase, like region servers, we would take a specific count of nodes where the threshold was defined, stop the services, reboot the nodes. When they came back up, we would move to the next batch, and there was a threshold defined. So if the threshold was met, it would stop, and then we would basically troubleshoot. So in supervisors, we would start the services, verify the services. Once all the supervisors were done, one group at a time, then we would move to DRPC. DRPC is like the distributed RPC for Storm. That was done, and then we would validate all the topologies that were running on the Storm cluster, audit all the components, run health checks, And once that was done, we concluded the completion of the cluster. Impact and statistics. So the target nodes, when we actually started doing the kernel upgrade, our target nodes were mostly running Red Hat Linux 6.4 and up to 6.8 with different kinds of minor kernel versions running on them. So and on that, we were having multiple hardware configs running on them, such as starting from Westmere to all the way to Broadwell. So we had to run a lot of tests before we actually started doing a production kernel upgrade. So there were a couple of issues that we faced, which we tried to fix before we actually moved to the production clusters. One was hardware. So these all nodes were not rebooted in a very, very long time. And when we actually rebooted and it had a hardware initialization, this exposed a lot of issues on the systems, right from bad motherboard to bad RAM, bad disk, bad power supply. So how we treated this problem was we ensured we had enough inventory on hand at the remote locations. So whenever we had these issues, we used to have the site ops replace the hardware and get it running. Then we had power boot failing due to iDRAC and IPMI. So iDRAC and IPMI are power management and console management tools, because of which the boot was failing. So for iDRAC, what we did was we disconnected the systems from iDRAC and allowed the systems to boot independently. For IPMI, we did multiple things. Among them, one thing was we flashed the BMC on these nodes to get them fixed. Slowness on systems. So couple of some particular config we had slowness. This was basically due to EDAC module. What was happening was the BIOS did not have the error code for the EDAC module, and it was spewing a lot of errors, which was basically slowing down the system. So we updated the BIOS, and then we also rebooted some systems. We fixed the BIOS. That way, we fixed the problem. For slow reboots, what was happening was during post and hardware initialization, some of the systems were taking as much as 45 minutes to come back up. And this was mostly because of BIOS corruption. So we had multiple solutions to this problem, and one of the solutions was using kexec. So kexec is a system call where we can boot a different kernel from an existing loaded kernel. So the difference between a kexec boot and a standard boot is the hardware initialization or post is skipped, and basically we are saving time with that. So we had approximately 3,000 nodes where we did a kexec boot. But doing a kexec boot, we did manage to hide the problem which would have got exposed with the reboots. So what we did was after we were done with the kernel upgrade, we did a rolling reboot on those nodes to make sure that all the problems were exposed and fixed. Success matrix. So one of the primary success matrix for us was zero data loss. So Hadoop, as we know, we keep multiple copies of data, and a lot of customers have huge confidence on their data that it's going to be safe, and we definitely want to keep that intact. So we ensured that there was zero data loss, and we did an upgrade on almost 47,000 nodes done at an extremely fast pace. Just to give you an example, we did a 6,000 plus node cluster in a single day. And this was done with minimum customer downtime and minimum impact to the low latency services. We did have a downtime on some of the components, but we used tools like BCP failover to make sure the impact was minimum. We also managed to resolve a S0 security bug. So when we actually got this bug from the security team, we were given a time frame of like 60 days to get it resolved, and we did manage to get it resolved within the time frame. Having done this, we got an opportunity to fix a lot of problems on the systems, upgrading BIOS, replacing a lot of hardware, and fixing the nodes, fixing the slowness on the systems. And basically, all this resulted in the improved system reliability. So that's it from our side. We are up for questions now.
Involved in executing those 6,000 nodes?
So there were like 3 to 4 operations engineers, and we had 1 or 2 dev engineers to handle escalations if we needed. And then we had a team of site ops who were there to help us if we needed remote support. No. I mean, we lost, we recovered.
So when you defined your rack stripes, did you just take one from each rack, or did you eventually increase the rack stripes?
Yeah, we did increase. I think Savita said we actually went very aggressive on some specific, I don't want to name the models, but there were real some good models. We realized that, hey, we are getting successful, so let's increase the rack. And we went all the way up to even 10 size stripe to achieve that. No. We had a threshold. So the moment the threshold was, we made sure that threshold was always kept at 1,000. So whether we take a rack stripe size of 10 or 1, the missing block was always 1,000 or even less. So the moment, even if we take 10, the moment the missing block threshold came by to 1,000, we stopped.
Fix them
and then. And then we fixed them. I can't hear you.
Yeah. Oh, we're running out of time.
No, we have 5 minutes more.
Okay. Okay.
No. We have like Yahoo specific tools that were used, and those were not considered. The automation was
we were using Apache
explicitly for this, yeah.
So we were, so as I said, we were, as Savita earlier said, that the name nodes were always in up mode. So we were definitely, if we were taking down the nodes all the time.
We were just shutting them down. We were not Yeah, we would shut down, reboot. Exactly, we brought the NN1 interface down, so jobs are not talking to the name node. I mean, it was failing. The primary interface was down.
Yeah.
So I might have missed you said this. So when you were, you know, restarting these data nodes, and someone were taking more than a half hour to come back, wouldn't the name node say,
So we had a setting on the name node where we had set up that the name node would not complain for a longer time. We had set up a refresh to 20 minutes. So instead of 10 minutes, so name node, they were reporting as missing blocks after 20 minutes instead of 10 minutes. So we were assuming that the name nodes will come back up within that time.
And if it did take more than that, then it would complain and we would get into it, get onto the console, see what the issue was, fix it and bring it back.
Yeah, that's what I was curious about, because if it took long to reboot, then the name node would say, you know, farm these blocks out to other data nodes.
So the standard was, we used to have the host come back up within 20 minutes. In case they didn't, they would come back, go in the missing block, and then we would get a threshold of like 1,000, we would stop. So most of the nodes used would come back within the 20 minutes time frame. No.
No, not currently. Yes, go ahead.
So if application is reading a data block, but the data block happens to be on the data node that you take down, so the application will not be able to use data anymore. It's going to fail.
Yes. So for Hadoop, it was a downtime upgrade where the NN1 interface was brought down, so applications were not talking to the name node. They would have failed out, so they couldn't get the information.
Missing you on that, the application would fail at that point, right?
There is a business continuity plan in place, so they would be running in a different cluster. So it was a downtime. Applications were not connecting to get the data stuff. I mean, jobs would fail, yes, agreed.
So they would fail over. They had a BCP where they would fail over to a different cluster. So they would be running the jobs on a different cluster.
Oh, okay.
No, whenever we'll have such OS issues, we will have to upgrade and we will have to. I mean, it doesn't do an auto upgrade, if that's what you're asking.
No, I'm asking if you've changed your scheduling so that way you don't have nodes that don't get bounced for ages. For instance, we go through a monthly patching schedule against every node in our cluster.
Yeah, but we don't reboot those nodes.
Okay, yeah,
don't reboot. We don't reboot, we don't have a schedule for rebooting those nodes. So we, our systems, we, basically we don't do FSCK, they are not auto FSCK on reboot. Yes, yes.
How do you guys handle, so the scenario that you guys went over was kernel upgrades and software updates within a RHEL release. What about going from say RHEL 6 to 7, major release?
We are actually working on that.
Thank you.
Thank you.